And therefore, when he died on the cross, do you accept that he died to save us from our sins?
No. You see, with apologies, you know, I'm reading this book, the Bible. I take it to you as English speaking.
Yes.
You are. That makes it better still. You see, you know, I'm telling the English speaking person, I said, you know, you read this book, the Bible, in your own mother tongue. Because the Bible is now available in 1,500 different languages. In Hindustani, in Tamil, in English, in Zulu, Afrikaans, what language you want? 1,500 different languages. Arabic, Gujarati, my language, 2 in Gujarati, I'll tell you why we have the time. Why 2 in Gujarati? 11 for the Arabs, 11 different Arabic Bibles. Man, no man has an excuse anymore for saying, you know, I haven't got access to the Word of God direct. But I said, no, you have it direct in English. And yet, I'm finding that the English man, when he's reading this book, I'm telling him, I said, you know, you are so programmed. With apologies. I said, you are so programmed that you are reading a book in your own mother tongue and you are made to understand the exact opposite of what you're reading. Not just misunderstanding. For example, if you read a statement, thou shalt not commit adultery, you are understanding thou shalt commit adultery. Now, how can you say that? You can be such perverts. Something special here has happened. That you're reading something and you're understanding the opposite of what you're reading. So what are you referring to? I said, you remember, sir, when Jesus returned to that upper room where they had the Last Supper after his alleged crucifixion. He goes in and he wishes his disciples, peace be unto you, shalom alaikum in Hebrew, peace be unto you. And when his disciples recognized that this is Jesus, they were all terrified. So I'm asking, why were they terrified? So Luke tells us that they were affrighted because they thought he was a spirit. He thought, I'm only quoting, because they thought he was. I said, why should they think the man is a spirit? Did he look like a spirit? Everybody says no. Then I said, why should they think the man is a spirit when he didn't look like one? Confused. So I said, look, I'll help you. You see, the disciples of Jesus, they had heard from hearsay that the master was hanged on the cross. They had heard from hearsay that he had given up the ghost, in other words, he had died, his spirit had come out. They had heard from hearsay that now he's dead and buried for 3 days. A man with such a reputation, when you see him, naturally you're terrified, because you expect him to be stinking in his grave. So, they were affrighted because they thought he was a spirit. So Jesus says, behold my hands and my feet, have a look at my hands and my feet, that it is I myself, I'm the same fellow man. What are you afraid of me for? Say, handle me and see. This is basic English. What is the Queen's English? You don't need a dictionary and you don't need a theology. Your book in your language. I'm reading it. Say, handle me and see. For a spirit has no flesh and bones as you see me have. A spirit has no flesh and bones. So if I got flesh and bones, in that case, I'm telling the Englishman, I'm not a spirit, I'm not a spook, I'm not a ghost, am I right? Is that what it means in your language? So everybody says yes. If I said I got flesh and bones, in that case, I'm not a spirit, I'm not a ghost, I'm not a spook. I'm asking the Afrikaner, is that what it means in your language? And he says yes. And the Zulu says yes. Everybody agrees, 100%. That if I have flesh and bones, then I'm not the other. I say, in other words, Jesus is telling you that the body that you are seeing, it is not a translated body, it is not a metamorphosed body, it is not a resurrected body. Because the resurrected bodies get spiritualized. So the learned man said, who says so? I said, Jesus. You say, where? I said, Luke chapter 20, verse 36. You were quoting 20, verse 36, go back, 4 chapters. So what does he say? You want me to tell you what he says, sir? He says, you see, the Jews were coming to him with poses, riddles, again and again. Now they come to him. They said, Master, there was a Jewess among us, and that Jewess, according to a Jewish custom, had 7 husbands. You know, if one fellow died and left no offspring, then the second fellow takes that wife. And when he fails, the third, and the fourth, and the fifth, sixth. 7 guys had this one woman. But there was no problem while here on this earth, because it was one by one. Now they want to know from Jesus that at the resurrection, which guy is going to have her, because they all had her here. In other words, if you had a woman here, then naturally when you see her on the other side, everybody says, Mefro, Meunga, my wife, everybody wants to grab her, 7 guys. There'll be a war in heaven between the 7 brothers for one woman, because they all wake up simultaneously. That's your belief, my belief. So 7 guys waking up and seeing this woman, everybody wants to grab her.
So there'll be war. It's mine.
That's the problem the Jews had in their mind. See, that there'll be a war in heaven between the brothers of the woman.
In answer to that, Jesus said, neither shall they die anymore. In other words, once they are resurrected, they'll be immortalized.
This is a mortal body, which has got its mortal needs, food,
shelter, clothing, sex, rest. Without these things,
no Englishman left, no African left, no Irishman left, no. All right.
You see, this is the law. Say, neither shall they die anymore, for they are equivalent to the angels. In other words, they will be angelized. The resurrected bodies will be angelized. They will be spiritualized. They will be spiritual creatures. They will be spirits. For they are equivalent to the angels and the children of God. Such are the children of the resurrection. Such spirits.
He said, the spirit has no flesh and bones, as you see me have, and they felt him, and they believed not for joy and wonder. I'm only reading.
It means they were overjoyed. What happened, man? He's alive. So he said, have you here any meat? Something to eat? And they gave him a piece of fried fish
and a honeycomb, and he took it, and he ate in the very sight. I said, to prove what? And the same for the man. Damn fools, what are you afraid of me for? Can't you see? With apologies.
You see, so I say, sir,
with apologies. Okay. You see, we are all being programmed from childhood into certain attitudes, into certain beliefs. We too. The Muslims is no exception to that rule. We are all getting programmed from childhood. You are also programmed. The only thing is that I am prepared to be deprogrammed. You know, the Muslims said, come, let's talk. Let's reason together. Let's have a dialogue. Reprogram me. Deprogram. Are you prepared to do that? I said, come, let us read this book. And I assure you that you have misunderstood every word by God. Every word you have misunderstood in your own language. If you read this in Hebrew and you said, look, I don't understand Hebrew, I can sympathize with you. If you read it in Greek and you said, look, I don't understand Greek, I can sympathize with you. But I said, you Englishman, you read the Bible in English and you have got the wrong end of the stick. And you African in Afrikaans, I said, you got the wrong end of the stick. And you Zulu in Zulu, I said, you got the wrong end of the stick. You are misunderstanding every word that's written.